We are joined once again by former Navy Chaplain Gordon Klingenschmidt, who is here today also under a new title, which is State Representative-elect Gordon Klingenschmidt in Colorado. Chaplain, congratulations. How did you do it?
Thank you, David. God bless you, and God bless your viewers today. I did it with grassroots effort, and I'm very humbled to have the support of 70% of the voters in my district, which is remarkable because we only have 43% of our district are registered Republicans. So when you have 43% Republicans and you win by a 70% landslide, even if all the Republican voters chose me and all the Democrats chose my opponent, that means we won 75% of unaffiliated voters in my district.
Which is incredible. Yeah, no, the math is correct, but a couple things. I mean, 43% registered Republicans is actually much higher than the national average because Colorado Springs is actually quite a conservative area. And then, of course, because it's a conservative area, a lot of those unregistered voters, as we see, as evidenced by you winning with a 70% margin, are very conservative. I mean, you are in one of the most conservative areas of the country.
Yes, and I owe a great debt of gratitude to the Republicans who have come before me to sort of prepare the ground, but also to my grassroots volunteers. I had 35 volunteers who were knocking on doors between 6 and 10 and 12,000 doors we knocked on in the primary and in the general, and also between 10 and 20,000 personal phone calls between the primary and the general. So the people really ran this campaign. For example, in the primary, I was outspent by another Republican 4.5-1 in personal funds. But my campaign was run by grassroots volunteers, mom and dad giving $25 or $50. And we caught up and they put us over the top, but they ran this campaign and they deserve a lot more credit perhaps than me.
Well, I want to talk about them, but before we get to that, you mentioned the Republicans that came before you. It doesn't really seem, based on the evidence, that the Republican Party in Colorado is too thrilled about your victory, because Republican Party chairman there, Ryan Call, said Gordon does not speak on behalf of the Republican Party. To suggest otherwise is inaccurate and dishonest. It seems, correct me if I'm wrong, like the Republican Party there in Colorado does not want anything to do with this victory you've had.
No, that's not quite accurate. In fact, I coordinated that statement with Ryan Call before he spoke to the press. Gosh, that was 2 or 3 months ago. Because you realize, David, I host a national TV show.
Right.
Pray in Jesus' Name News. And that TV show is not endorsed by the Republican Party. And so when we say things on our TV show and I talk about my religious views, of course that's not the same as the Republican Party's official views or the Republican platform, which I fully support and agree with, but I don't claim to speak for them, and I don't claim their endorsement when I'm doing my religious work. You liberals are always complaining, oh, we need more separation of church and state, but at the same time, when I try to say, well, here are my Republican views, they're different than my religious views, everyone's attacking me because you can't differentiate those, and I'm not the one trying to do that.
Well, hey, listen, Gordon, I'm not attacking you. I literally just read what a Republican said about you. To say that I'm attacking you or you liberals, I mean, I asked because
it's
just a
statement
of fact.
Well, you know how that's fun, David. You've seen the blogosphere and people trying to conflate those, then say, oh, he's too religious to be electable. Apparently, the voters think otherwise. In fact, this is a record turnout nationwide for church-based voters. This was a social conservative victory nationwide. If you look, for example, in the two races in Colorado between Cory Gardner for U.S. Senate and Bob Beaupre for Colorado governor, those are both statewide races here in Colorado, and I supported both of those candidates. But Cory Gardner ran sort of as a social conservative, and he won. Bob Beaupre, by all accounts here, was perceived as a moderate Republican, didn't talk about social issues, and he lost.
No, I get that, but I'm curious, though. I have a different question, which is, I agree with you that much of the exit polls show us that, and part of this is because, at least nationally, you know, you only have 1/3 of senators up for re-election every 2 years, and not all governors are up for re-election, and this was a very convenient set of candidates for the Republican Party. But I don't want to focus on that. The question I have for you is, we had what you describe here as this resurgence of the church vote, the social conservative vote, but we have today, as you and I speak, a record number of states that now allow same-sex marriage, and there is no question at all that 12 months from now we will have even more. So does it really even matter to you in the sense that the so-called church vote came out, but we're still getting more and more states every other month that are legalizing same-sex marriage? I don't think that's going to change, is it?
Well, David, as you know, 38 states had passed traditional marriage laws, and only 3 states have voted for homosexual marriage.
Oh, and come on. But Gordon, you and I have done this before. I know. Yeah.
You mentioned there's 32 states now that have legalized gay marriage, but actually they've had that imposed upon them by tyrannical judges who were unelected, and you cannot be held accountable. So,
but Gordon, hold on. Let's you and I have done this before. Let's be as pragmatic as possible. Aside from the fact that you disagree with how same-sex marriage became legal, let's put that aside for a second. You can't deny the fact that every year we are seeing an acceleration of legalization of same-sex marriage. That's an empirical reality.
I think this year's election was a repudiation of that judicial tyranny. I think the people of Colorado have voted 3 times for marriage between one man and one woman.
Okay.
The people of Colorado are angry and frustrated, and that's why Cory Gardner was able to mobilize the social conservative vote, and Bob Beaupre was not able to do that. This was a victory for the church, and we're fighting back against that tyranny.
All right. So we'll explore over the next year how that goes in terms of in practice with law. Let's talk a little bit about your plans as a legislator. And my question really comes down to whether some of the issues that you've talked about over the last few years on our program and on yours will be in any way applied to how you will legislate. So, for example, gay exorcism has been this huge thing. You're so known, right? Every website has been writing about how you believe in exorcising the gay out of people. You once exorcised the gay out of a lesbian, and she cried and accepted Jesus, and she hasn't gone back ever since. Is there any way in which gay exorcism would translate into your role as an upcoming member of the House of Representatives?
No, David, but I'm honored to be featured. I think I was the lead story on Rachel Maddow and Ed Schultz concerning that. Think Progress made me their number one enemy, or, you know, craziest conservative elected this year.
Right.
But honestly, as a PhD in theology, I wrote my dissertation about the traditional theology of St. Ignatius of Loyola and the Bible and the gift of discerning of spirits. That's an academic defense, and it was, you know, they called me doctor because I wrote about that topic. That doesn't mean that people should be attacking my religious views, and that was never part of my campaign for public office.
Hold on a second, though, Gordon. Is just stating that you have this long history of claiming to perform gay exorcisms with a roughly 50% success rate, like if I've just stated that, that's not an attack on you, right?
No, but you've seen how they're saying that disqualifies me for public office. But the Constitution says the opposite. The Constitution says there is no religious litmus test for office. Just because I hold my religious views as a former Navy chaplain and I perform my religion behind closed doors in a certain way does not disqualify me from also running as a business leader with an MBA, campaigning for lower taxes, more freedom, less regulation, more jobs, stronger economy, stronger Second Amendment rights, stronger, you know, religious freedom for people like the baker in Denver, Jack Phillips, who is now being violated against his conscience, forced to make wedding cakes for 2 men from Massachusetts.
Yeah, but you know that's we're not going to agree on that, chaplain. You know that actually that his, you know, that's not a violation of religious freedom. That's an imposition of a religious belief on civil society. But you and I won't agree on that. I know that. ISIS. You've said that ISIS is a sign of the end times. And you're not the only one who has said this. People like Matthew Hagee have said it. There's many others that point to ISIS as a sign of the end times, Ebola as a sign of the end times. Do you, as a former Navy chaplain and as a deeply religious man, as you've indicated, do you look forward to the end times, rapture, apocalypse? Is that something you look forward to eagerly?
No, I'm a post-trib believer, which in Christian theology means that I believe Christians are going to suffer in the end times, and nobody looks forward to that.
So you're after trib.
Right. The Bible does say in Revelation 20 that you know, talking about the martyrs who were beheaded on behalf of, because of their testimony for Jesus Christ. And I did make a comparison. When ISIS is beheading the Mosul Christians who have lived in that area for two millennia and their children are being beheaded, that is a sign, and that's what the prophet John saw when he wrote the book of Revelation in chapter 20.
Okay, so the end times, even though you believe they're coming, you're not looking forward to it. Why even run, right? If we're so close to the end times, why get involved in a political campaign and legislating when it's all going to be over soon?
Because Jesus has commanded us to occupy until he comes. In other words, we are to establish the kingdom of God as much as we can.
Yeah.
And there's always going to be a battle between God and the devil among us people here on earth during our lifetimes, but our job is to represent Jesus Christ in that compassion, that spirit of love. Listen, I built an orphanage for 94 children in India. We're taking care of widows and orphans. We have compassion for the poor. As a former Navy chaplain, my programs won 6 awards because we fed the homeless every Friday. I'm going to continue that legacy of community service when I'm in public office.
All right. To remind everybody, we've been speaking with State Representative-elect and former Navy chaplain Gordon Klingenschmidt in Colorado. He has said that he is not going to apply his gay exorcism as a state legislator. We will pause here on the radio and TV show. Stay with us because we are going to hear a death threat voicemail that the chaplain has received. And the full video will be posted on our YouTube channel. So, Chaplain, you have this death threat that you've received, which you want to play for us. Before you play it, what are you trying to illustrate for us by playing this voicemail?
Well, there's this impression in the public that the gay movement is all tolerant and friendly, and we're the haters, right? They accuse Christians. By the way, David, in 7 years of daily blogging, I have never once said that I hate any person. I've never once said that I fear any person. And yet we are labeled as, you know, bigots and phobias and all the things that they throw at us by activists who are dishonest and they represent us falsely. But I want to play for you a couple, you know, I got 2 or 3 death threats by email this past 6 weeks as I was running. They have been reported to the FBI. One of the emails said they wanted to put a 9mm bullet in my brain. And then I got this really friendly voicemail. I want your viewers to be aware of this because the FBI is investigating and they're taking it seriously. And this person who left this voicemail may be prosecuted. I'll leave him to speak for himself in his own words.
Okay.
Let me tell you something, you goddamn fuck. You don't like gay people, motherfucker? You don't want to meet me, you piece of shit. I will slit your goddamn fucking throat, you garbage filled motherfucker. Watch your goddamn fucking back, you prick! I'll kill you!
Yeah, there's no question that that's a lot of crazy, but you know, I know that you and I disagree about a lot of things, but I know that we would both agree that you playing one voicemail or me playing the 2 or 3 like that I get every week, those are anecdotal bits of evidence. That doesn't really tell us anything more broadly, right, about who's issuing threats. You're on one side, so by its very nature, you'll get more threats from the side that disagrees with you, and the same would apply to me.
Well, I would denounce any threats against you, David. I'm sure you, I hope, would denounce any threats against me. In fact, the Speaker of the Colorado State House, Mark Ferrandino, who is openly gay, has denounced anybody who would, you know, issue threats against me and say, you know, Klingenschmidt has a right to freedom of speech, and I believe in freedom of speech, but I don't think death threats are included in freedom of speech. So
I agree with you. No, listen, Chaplain, I agree with you. We have no disagreement on this. I am curious, though. How will it be, you know, you've talked about how you believe that those who are gay are going to end up in hell. You've talked about this for so long. Can you take seriously, as Speaker of the House, someone who is, as you describe, openly gay? It would seem like a contradiction in the sense that, on the one hand, this is the Speaker of the House, and that's an authority that this individual has endowed in him by the state. But at the same time, your views about what it means and what the consequences are of homosexuality are so specific. How could you work with someone like that?
Well, you know, the election is behind us, and my religious views, again, are mostly stated on my TV show and in my Christian ministry. as an elected official, I will probably tone down the rhetoric. I don't have any reason to talk about those things under the Capitol dome. I honestly want to build bridges with members of the opposition party. I may not vote with them very often, but we can all be personable and friendly. I just went out to a pub the other day with five freshman legislators. They were all female. They were all Democrats. And we sat around the pub laughing and joking. They all drank beers and I had an iced tea.
Yeah, it's so funny. For whatever reason, the second you said you went to a pub, I assumed that you didn't drink alcohol. I don't know why that entered my mind.
Well, I may sip occasionally in private, but not in public. I don't want to set a bad example. But I do I do care about, you know, I suppose everybody. I want to represent, and I was elected to represent everybody, whether they're independent or Democrat or Republican, whether they are Christian or Jewish or Muslim or atheist.
Yeah.
You know, I believe in the First Amendment. As a Navy chaplain, I always facilitated for people of all diverse faiths, and I will continue to care for everybody, even if I don't always vote the way that some Democrats would want me to vote.
Well, Chaplain, as I'm sure you know, I believe this is an incredible story from Navy chaplain to lesbian exorciser to state representative-elect, former Navy chaplain Gordon Klingenschmitt. I'm as curious as everyone else to see what the next couple of years bring, Chaplain. Thank you.
Thank you, David. You'll be on my speed dial. We'll be in touch.